Shalom, my friends. Welcome to Weekly Parsha with Yehuda. And this week is Parshat Ki Tisa. This is the infamous Parsha of the Golden Calf, and plenty of interesting opportunities for us to explore in this week's Parsha. So it starts off with discussing the counting of Israel regarding the half shekel, which is an interesting idea, especially since this half shekel has a very special purpose. As we go down and it discusses the importance of this half shekel, it says that it is used in which to atone for your souls. What's fascinating about this is that this is the same language that is used in Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11, that a lot of people like to use, that says the blood that has been given on the altar is used to atone for your souls. Well, guess what? The same language is used here. Lekaper al nafsoteichem, right? Nafsoteichem, right? So this refers to the atonement of your souls. Lekaper al nafsoteichem. So what does that mean? Well, it means that Hebrews 9:22 is a false statement that says the only way to receive forgiveness of sins is through the shedding of blood. That's not what Exodus chapter 30 says. It says the opposite. It says in verses 15 and 16, it says it twice. It says that this is for the atonement of your souls. Al nafshoteichem, lechaper al nafshoteichem. So look at Leviticus 17:11, and you'll see the same expression is used in Hebrew. So anyone claiming that you cannot receive atonement without blood, hogwash. There are certain instances where that is not the case. Once we get into Leviticus, we'll have another experience where we can explain how Jews, or you know, the Israelites, will deal with atonement during times of exile. But here we have more discussion regarding the priestly activities with the meeting of the altar and sort of priestly rituals of hand washing and the ideas of it speaks about the spices, right? The ketoret, also used for atonement in certain contexts later in the Bible, as we will see. That's in the book of Bamidbar and Numbers. So just giving sort of the recipe for the ketoret. And here we have this infamous word, mishchat, right? Mishchat, which is a word that is related to the root Mashiach, right? Very famous word that is used in many, many religious connotations regarding the future Messiah. But clearly we see the word being used as simply anointing of different vessels, right? You can anoint the tent of meeting and the ark of testimony. So you see, it's not just referring to a human being anointed with oil, but also objects and even, you know, within the context of like the temple. So when you see in Daniel chapter 9, which often comes up in conversation regarding, with Christians, they will claim that because it says the word Mashiach in Daniel 9:26, it can only refer to the Messiah, son of David. Well, that would be silly, considering the fact that this word is all over the place, right? And it doesn't refer necessarily even to a human being. Sometimes it refers to a high priest, right? Which is why a lot of people understand that Mashiach being cut off to be referring to either the high priest at the time or even the temple itself, right? So this is just giving us further understanding here. And so here, so it says the table and all its implements and the menorah and its implements and the altar of incense. I wanted to go back for a second to last week's Parsha because the menorah is a very interesting conversation regarding, so this is in Parsha Titzaveh, right? So I mentioned last week, we discussed the kindling of the lamps that will be, you know, the menorahs that's going to be kindled, for the ner, it says, will be ner tamid, right? It's going to kindle continually, right? So you see in synagogues, sometimes they have like a fire on the, you know, representing a fire in the middle of the sanctuary hanging. That's called the ner tamid to commemorate this. But here's an interesting thing, is that on the Sabbath, right, it says you're not supposed to kindle a fire. So how do you square that, right? So that's why, you know, you had this tradition of the Sadokim or the Sadducees who would sit in the dark because they took that literally, do not kindle a fire on the Sabbath. But clearly that's not what God intended, because you even have sacrifices on the Sabbath that involve fire offerings. So what does that mean? So according to, you know, rabbinic understanding, that means that you can make a fire before Shabbat, but you're not allowed to make a fire during Shabbat. You're not allowed to ignite a flame, and you're also not supposed to extinguish a flame. So that's what it means. Don't kindle a fire on Shabbat. It doesn't mean that you can't benefit at all from a fire, right? Otherwise, how do you do sacrifices on Shabbat? That wouldn't make any sense. So, yeah. That's why you need an oral tradition, or else you're going to do something silly, like sit in the dark all day on the Sabbath and not understand the full context of what's happening here. Just another reason why, you know, you need an oral tradition in order to understand how to even practically keep the Torah. If you don't keep the Sabbath every week, then you wouldn't really think about these types of things. But when you actually do and implement and keep Shabbat, keep the commandments, you quickly see that there has to be some sort of oral tradition that went along with this. So here you have this word, Tim Shach, which refers to, you know, the anointing of Aaron and his sons, right? So clearly the word Mashiach here, that's where this comes from. Tim Shach, right? Not exclusive to the Messiah, son of David. So why would we assume in Daniel 9 that that's the only thing it could refer to, is the Messiah, son of David? That is why Jews reject the interpretation that the Messiah had to come before the destruction of the Second Temple. Very simple explanation. The word is never used to exclusively refer to the Messiah, son of David, son of, you know, anywhere in the Tanakh. Daniel 9 would be the only exception. So anyone want to challenge me on that, I would show me anywhere in the Tanakh where the word Mashiach is used to exclusively refer to the Messiah, son of David, other than the erroneous Christian interpretation of Daniel 9. You won't find it. So there, that's all you need to do to debunk this Daniel 9. Messiah had to come before destruction of the Second Temple. No, clearly not. You don't understand basic Hebrew if that is the hill you're going to die on. So anyway, moving on in the Parsha, you have, you know, discussion of holiness, the anointing of Aaron and his sons, the Kohanim, speaking about the aromatics, the ketoret, the incense mixture that is spoken about. Once again, as I said later in the, you see that it's used for atonement. Fine, so he's talking about crushing the incense for the holiness. And Bezalel, okay, so here we have a very important figure. Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Yehuda. And he has imbued him, Bezalel, God imbued him with wisdom, bechokhma, uvid, and it says, vitvina, uvidaat. You know what that means? Chokhma bina daat. Chochma bina das, Chabad. I always find it ironic because I don't know a lot of Chabadniks with the name Bezalel so often, but that is the Chabad name, the most Chabad name you could possibly have, because this is what Chochma bina and das, which stands for Chabad. That's the acronym, if you didn't know. So Bezalel, that he was the original Chabadnik. I'm just kidding. I don't know what he was, but whatever. You know what I'm saying. So, yeah, he was basically the, you know, he was endowed with this spirit of being able to do crafts so that they could, you know, work on the Mishkan. He basically created was with the help of Aholiav, who was of the tribe of Dan, who also has given this wisdom. I guess he was given chokhmah. I guess he didn't have the bina and the das. I'm just kidding. But, yeah. So they were the duo that created, you know, the Mishkan together. You got the menorah, burnt offerings. Yep, yeah, as we discussed before, you need some context as to how that works. You had fire offerings on the Sabbath. So how do you square that with not, not supposed to kindle a fire on the Sabbath? You need an oral tradition to understand this stuff. No way around it. And here's that word Mashiach again. Hamishcha, right? The anointing oil and the incense, right? Not just for, the future Messiah, but also for high priests, right? Got prophets being anointed. So then it talks about keeping the Sabbath for all your generations, right? It doesn't say that when Jesus comes, you stop keeping the Sabbath and you just, right? Very important, right? Dire consequences if you don't keep it. And this is a very famous line that we say every Shabbat, and I'm in the Shabbat mood since it's a Friday, so I'll say it, a little preemptively, because it's beautiful. V'shameru v'nei Yisrael et ha-shabbat. La'asot et ha-shabbat. L'dorotam berit olam. Beni uve b'nei Yisrael, oti le'olam, ki sheshet yamim, asa Hashem, et ha-shamayim v'et ha-aretz. Uvayom hashvi shavad vayinavosh. This is what we say every Friday night. We say it during the day. Some reform tunes do it a little differently. You got the Vishamru v'nei Yisrael et ha-shabbat. Woo! If you're familiar with that tune. But yeah, very famous tune and very, very important to keeping Shabbat. So moving on to chapter 31. This is the end of 31. My bad. So then it says, when he had finished speaking to him at Mount Sinai, he gave Moses the two tablets of the testimony, stone tablets written with the finger of God. So these original tablets kind of like pierced through the stone so you could see from both sides. So very unique set of tablets. Very holy. Obviously, we don't mean a literal finger, but, Anyway, anthropomorphic language is used to help us to understand what's happening here. So here was the infamous part with the golden calf, right? Exodus 32. It says, when the people saw that Moses was late and coming down from the mountain, the people gathered against Aaron and they said to him, come on, make us gods that will go before us, because this man Moses who brought us up from the land of Egypt, we don't know what has become of him. So they lost faith in the fact that, I guess they miscalculated, right? As Rashi describes. And it says that, the Satan showed them something resembling Moses being carried in the air high above the sky, and it directed in a way that we should not go. Now we need gods to go before us instead of Moses. So the idea was, I guess they wanted to replace Moses, some of the rabbinic commentaries explain, because they were scared. They didn't have a leader. So this golden calf thing happened. So Aaron, the rabbinic commentaries explain... he's trying to stall, right? It says that Aaron said, remove the golden earrings that are on the ear of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them those earrings to me. And he says, Aaron said to himself, the women and the children are fond of their jewelry. Perhaps the matter will be delayed, and in the meantime, Moses will arrive. But they did not wait for their wives and children to give them their ears. They took off their own earrings. Okay, so it wasn't stalling as much as he wanted. They stripped themselves of the golden earrings and on the ears, and they brought them to Aaron. And he took them and fashioned it with an engraving tool and made it into a molten calf, which they said, these are your gods, O Israel, who have brought you up from the land of Egypt. similar to when Christians like to say that, you know, Jesus is your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Chas v'shalom l'havdil. It never says that in the Tanakh, right? Anybody can attribute the actions of God to anything that they want. It doesn't mean that it's true. So you can say this golden calf took Israel out of Egypt, just as it says in the Bible, you know, like where it doesn't say that, of course, just as it doesn't say that Jesus brought the Jews or Israel out of Egypt, right? So it's silly when Christians bring this up as though, oh no, Jesus was there the whole time. He was always doing all this stuff. It doesn't say it in the Tanakh. You might as well tell me that a golden calf did it if you're going to say Jesus did it. It's just simply not there. It's circular reasoning. Simple as that. So I think there's some midrashim. Yeah, here's it talks about this interesting midrash where it says that there was a plate that was in his hand. When they were making the molten calf, it said, "Ascend, O ox," and miraculously Joseph, that was what was used, I guess, to bring up the bones of Joseph from the Nile. And I guess that "Ascend, O ox" inscription was thrown into the crucible and the calf emerged and supposedly it like danced around and I guess it looked kind of miraculous. So I guess it tricked a lot of the people into thinking it had some sort of divine, you know, relation to God. Anyway, so a festival was proclaimed and obviously this was where a lot of sin took place. One of the worst sins, the lowest point in Israel's history. And of course, Christians love to, you know, rub our eyes in the sand about this. Muslims do it too. Look, we can take personal responsibility for our actions, but that doesn't mean that God, you know, breaks his covenant with us simply because of this, you know, and we'll see later in the Parsha exactly what that means, right? So right here, it says, the Lord said to Moses, go descend for your people that you have brought up from the land of Egypt have acted corruptly. They have quickly turned away from the path that I have commanded them. They have made themselves a molten calf, and they have prostrated themselves before it, slaughtered sacrifices to it. These are your gods, O Israel, who you have brought out of the land of Egypt, right? That's what they said. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, and behold, they are stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone. My anger will be kindled against them so that I will annihilate them, and I will make you into a great nation. Wow. So God is threatening to destroy the entire nation of Israel and make a new group of people that Moses can lead. But Moses pleaded before God. Watch this. Moses challenges God. And he says, why, O Lord, should your anger be kindled against your people, whom you have brought out from the land of Egypt with great power and a strong hand? Why should the Egyptians say he brought them out with evil, to kill them in the mountains and to annihilate them from upon the face of the earth, right? Moses is saying, like, what was the whole point of the Exodus if you were just going to kill the people who you just saved? Retreat from the heat of your anger and reconsider the anger or the evil, right, intended for your people. So Moses is saying, relent of your anger and instead, have mercy on these people, on Israel. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, to whom you swore by your very self, to whom you said, I will multiply your seed like the stars of the heavens, and all this land which I would give your seed, they shall keep it as their possession forever. And the Lord reconsidered the evil he had said he would do to his people. Moses challenged God and held him to his promise, and God reconsidered. His child has defeated him. You catch that? You get that? If you know, you know. Once again, you see that Moses was able to challenge God's word based on his own word and to effect change in a positive way, effectively saving the people through his own prayer, through his own understanding of God's word. Isn't that amazing? No Jesus blood required. Moses turned and went down to the mountain, bearing the two tablets of testimony in his hand. The tablets were inscribed from both sides, on one side and the other, and they were inscribed, right? So this is the unique set of tablets. And then Joshua heard the people, and he said, there's a voice of battle in the camp, so there's a lot of fighting going on. And but Moses said, it's neither a voice of shouting victory nor shouting defeat, a voice of blasphemy I hear. So he came closer to the camp, and he saw what was happening with the calf and the dances, and he got so angry that he threw those tablets on the ground, and they shattered on the foot of the mountain. And he took the golden calf they made, burned it in the fire, ground it in the power, scattered it upon the surface of the water, and gave it to the children of Israel to drink. Ugh, what a horrible punishment. And it looks like, Moses confronted Aaron about this, and he said, let not the Lord's anger grow hot. You know that the people, they are disposed toward evil. And he said to me, make gods who will go before us, because this man Moses, who brought us up from the land, we do not know what has become of him. So that was the reason why. And I said to them, who has gold? So he made it into a calf, and he saw the people and exposed, and Aaron had exposed them to be disgraced before their adversaries. And he says, whoever is with the Lord, come with me. And all the sons of Levi gathered around him. So they say that the tribe of Levi was not, involved in the sin of the golden calf so much, which distinguished them from the rest of Israel, which eventually what gave them unique priestly status. I guess, chronologically, we already see that Aaron has this status, but I guess the entire tribe was given more in this context. So you see a lot of people fell. A lot of death happened after this incident of the golden calf. Very sad, very low moment for us. So now we have to deal with atonement for our sin, right? And, right, the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will erase him from my book, right? So, but of course, God is merciful, and we do, these verses don't exist in a vacuum. Just because you have sinful people among Israel, it does not mean that they are eternally, cursed and they don't have any means of reconciling with God. Certainly not through Jesus' blood. That's never, an option or whatever. So plagues and just horrible things happening. So Exodus 33, here's a really interesting part of the Parsha where it says, the Lord spoke to Moses, go ascend from here, and the people I brought from the land of Egypt that I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, said to your descendants, right? Talking about the angel. It says an angel. It doesn't, necessarily say the angel of the Lord, but that's how this is understood to be. And it's never described as Jesus. So once again, the great Jesus angel hunt falls flat on its face because it has no substantiation from the Tanakh, or really even from the New Testament. The Lord said to Moses, say to the children of Israel, you were stiff-necked people, and he says, if I go up in the midst for one moment, I will destroy you, but now leave your finery and I will know what to do to you. So, clearly the stakes are high. Ultimately, there's, a lot of atonement that needs to be done. And it's describing Moses going in and out of the tent and the pillar of cloud that would descend in the entrance of the tent, and God would speak to Moses. And it's describing the events of this meeting, right? And the Lord would speak to Moses face to face as a man would speak. And that's an expression of speech. It doesn't mean that God actually showed his face to Moses. As we see later in this chapter, it says that no one can see God's face and live. So this isn't a literal statement. And it says he would return to the camp, but his attendant Joshua, son of Nun, the lad, would not depart from the tent. So just describing the events of that. Moses said to the Lord, look, you say to me, bring this people up, but you have not informed who you were sent to me. I've known you by name, and I also found favor in your eyes, right? So this discussion with God about the presence, right? And God says, he said, my presence will go and I will give you rest. And he said to him, if your presence does not go with us, do not take us up from there, right? So this is discussing, there's going to be a very intimate encounter that Moses has with God that is unprecedented. No other prophet. This is what makes Moses such a unique prophet. We're going to see by the end of this chapter. And the Lord said to Moses, even this thing that you have spoken, I will do, for you have found favor in my eyes, and I have known you by name, right? And he said, show me your glory, right? This is what Moses says. It was time for God to, you know, have this very unique experience with Moses. And he said, I will let my goodness pass before you, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before you, and I will favor when I wish favor, and I will have compassion when I wish to have compassion. So this is the most intimate experience that anyone has ever had with God. Only Moses knows this experience. But what God did say is, you will not be able to see my face, for man shall not see me and live. So when we see Jacob saying, I've seen the face of, you know, it says Elohim and still live, it doesn't mean that he's seeing the face of God. That would contradict this verse, right? No man can see me and live. When he said, I saw the face of Elohim, he wasn't saying that he saw the face of Yud-Kei Vav-Kei. He saw an angel, as we know. So when Christians try to distort that and say that, you know, Jacob was seeing the literal face of God, you have to square that with this. God says, no man may see me and live. You can't see my face, right? So, yeah, just explaining that so that nobody takes that out of context, which, of course, many Christians do. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place for me, right? The place with me, and you shall stand on a rock. And it will be that when my glory passes by, I will place you in a cleft in the rock, and I will cover my hand until I pass by. Now, this isn't, you know, obviously this is anthropomorphic. It's not real hands, real, you know, this sort of thing. It's not a real back, right? So, yeah, it says this is a euphemism out of honor for the Most High. He does not need to cover him, Moses, with an actual hand. That should be obvious. But sometimes you have to explain this. And he said to Moses, hew yourself two stone tablets like the first one, right, and prepare for the morning. And so he made a new set of tablets, and it says the Lord passed before him and proclaimed. And this is a very famous phrase that we say most particularly during the high holidays. We say, Hashem, Hashem, kel rachum v'chanun, erech apayim v'rav chesed v'emet, notzer chesed lalafim, no se avon vafesha vechata avinake. That's usually the part that we say to invoke the attributes of mercy, right? These are known as the Yod Gimel Midot, the 13 attributes of Hashem. And that's why we say this. And then it says that preserving the loving kindness for thousands, forgiving iniquity and rebellion of sin, he does not completely cover the sin. He visits upon the parents and the children and the children's children of third and fourth generations the sin, right? That's what's important too. And this is why I'm not privy to use Ezekiel 18, because it's much more, you know, when I debate with missionaries, a lot of people like to use Ezekiel 18 and say that the sons will not die for the sins of the fathers. Well, it's a little more complicated than that. And you have to look at this passage and understand what that means. You know, the death of the righteous atoning for sin, and that there can be a certain level of, you know, understanding beyond that. And it's not as simple as, you know, no man can die for another man's sins. It's very contextual based upon, you know, what that means. If they continue in the sin of their fathers, that's how it's understood a lot of the time, then they're responsible. But if they don't, it's a bigger discussion. If you want me to go into more detail, I can. But that's why you'll see on my channel, I'm usually not using the Ezekiel 18 arguments. But yeah, either way, you don't need Jesus' blood. That's ultimately what it comes down to. Jesus' blood is not required for atonement for sin, forgiveness of sin in any context. If there's one thing you can get from this Parsha, that would be, something important. So you shall forgive the iniquity in our sin and thus secure us as your possession, right? So very intimate moment. Only Moses, right, experiences this. No one else. With regards to that intimate experience with God, which is once again why he is the greatest prophet ever in existence. And so to discuss a covenant of peace with the people, just making sure and talking about the future with, you know, going into the land, building a covenant, talking about, you know, the future going into the land of Israel and discussing what that's going to look like, telling Israel not to, you know, intermingle with the pagan nations, not making molten gods. It's talking about keeping a festival of, it says Chag HaMatzot, which is also known as Pesach, Passover, and talking about in the springtime, Aviv, and talking about, I guess this is a firstborn donkey you shall redeem with the land. It's interesting. 6 days you shall work, and on the seventh day, rest. And then it's talking about the festival, Chag Shavuot, right? This is the festival of weeks, also known as the Bikurim, right? The first fruits, as a lot of people know it. It says 3 times a year, all the males shall appear before the master, the Lord, God of Israel, right? The Shalosh Regalim, as they are known. Shavuot, Pesach, and Sukkot. I haven't seen Sukkot mentioned yet. You shall not slaughter or sprinkle. Well, I guess it also includes like Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah. I think I mentioned that before. Oh, here's the, you shall not cook a kid in its mother's milk, right? That, you know, famous idea of why Jews don't mix milk and meat together. The oral tradition of what that means, you know, we can go into that in a different video if anyone wants me to talk about the halachic and, you know, information. Right. So anyway, so to conclude in the final chapter, the final Aliyah, so Lord spoke to Moses, inscribe these words for yourself, and formed a covenant with you in Israel, and 40 days and 40 nights, right? Very common numeric pattern here. And we see God speaking to the community. Oh, this is the interesting passage with the veil that was put over Moses' face that was mistranslated as infamously known, where like some people thought that Jews had horns because I think there was like a mistranslation of one of these where I can't remember exactly the context of it, but there was a picture that was supposed to have light shining off of Moses' face. When he came off the mountain, and I guess someone thought it was horns, so people thought that Jews had horns or something. I think that's where some people say that myth, that false myth came from. The rays of the splendor from Moses' face was blinding and radiant, so he used a veil to cover his face. All right, so yeah, that's Parshat Ki Tisa. I hope this video has been a blessing to you. Please share, like, and subscribe, and have a wonderful Shabbat for all who observe, and Shalom Aleichem.